Good evening, listeners. My name is Ramamed, your duty continuity announcer at this time. Our next program is Geography 1, 2, 3. Happy listening.
Good morning, class. This is Geo 1, 2, 3. Man and his environment. A course for NC1 students. I, H. Salahuddin, is here to present the course. So, these are the course content, or rather we say the course outline. If I'll go into the course in detail. The first content is that we are going to look at the definition, the scope, and classification of environment. Then we are going to look at land and agricultural systems. Also, we are going to look at environmental balance and intervention in the natural environment. Environmental perception and philosophy. You as a man, or as a woman being, how do you perceive the environment? We determine or how you interact with your environment. Then also we are going to look at environmental hazards in Nigeria. What are these hazards? We have soil erosion, drought, desert encroachment, flooding, oil spillage, and pollution. After looking at these hazards, we are going to look at the causes. We are going to look at the effects and management in Nigeria and other countries. That is, other environmental hazards that happen in other countries, how do they manage such hazards? We are also going to look at environmental laws and policies, global and within. What is the international standards, and also what is happening here in Nigeria. Then, lastly, we are going to look at environmental education and decision making. And if you look at the course outline, you can see that the sole aim of this course is for us to know about our environment. Hence, environmental education and decision making. So, as we have said earlier, this course is man and his environment. Man and his environment. Man, as we know, is that species on earth that mostly modifies the environment. Because man, that is the present day man, Homo sapiens, he's upright, he stands on our 2 feet, we also have faculty of thinking. That's why we are different from other species that have ever evolved. And this man modifies his environment, and this man is also responsible for the alteration, that is changing and destruction of ecosystems. As I've said earlier, man mostly modifies the environment, and this man is also responsible for what? Alteration and destruction of ecosystem. With globalization, we know what we mean by globalization, increased trade, tourism, and transport of goods and services between different countries. The phenomenon of the spread of alien species increase now exponentially. As I've said earlier, man is the species that most modify the environment, and is also responsible for the alteration and destruction of ecosystem. What is the importance of environment to man existence? That is, the importance of environment to the existence of man. The natural environment provides for all other environments, What are these other environments? We have social, cultural, education, political. All these ones are what? Man-made environment. So it is this natural environment that provides for all other environments that I have mentioned. What are these other environments? I say we have social, cultural, education, and political. We have others too. So this natural environment provides for all other environments, those things that are basic to life and which help in making existence of man possible in all the environment. Note, man and the environment are created to interact with each other on balance basis. That is equilibrium. We have 50-50 at each side. Why the natural environment is to create a fair, decent shelter to provide food, supplements, economic resources. What are these economic resources? We have gold. We have crude oil. That is one of the natural resources we have comparative advantage on to other countries, and so on. Man, on the other hand, is supposed to do what? To take care and protect the environment from destruction. Hence, the need for what? Environmental education. That is, for us to take care and protect the environment, we have to know, we have to be aware of the environment. We know what the environment is, what it entails, what to do and what not to do. Hence, the need for what? Environmental education. So what is this environmental education, which I say is the sole aim of this course? It's the process that allows individual to explore environmental issues, engage on problem solving, and take action to improve the environment. When you do that, you live sustainably. Hence, the need for sustainable development. So all this is just introduction into the course. As I've said earlier, the course is on man and his environment. So now we take the first item on the course outline, which is what? The definition and scope. The definition, scope, and classification of an environment. There are a lot of definitions for the word environment in the literal and scientific context. But the most acceptable definition can be given as environment can be defined as the natural surrounding of that organism which directly or indirectly influences the growth and development of the organism. That's one definition. Another definition, according to International Standard Organization, defines environment as a surrounding in which an organism operates, including air, water, land, and natural resources. We have flora and fauna, that is plant and animal, humans and their interrelation. And also, environment can be defined as the sum total of all living and non-living factors that compose the surrounding of a man. When you look at this definition, you can see that environment has been environment being such a generalized term in its classification and composition of its composition becomes necessary. That is, environment is a generalized term. So there's need for us to be able to classify, and each classes under each classification or class, we should be able to look at its composition for us to really understand what environment is. So classification of environment. Environment is classified into three major divisions. We have the physical environment, biological, and the cultural environment. The physical environment entails atmosphere, hydrosphere, lithosphere. The biological environment entails flora, fauna, and microbial, while the cultural environment consists of the society, economy, and politics. The physical environment covers the atmosphere. What is the atmosphere? It is the envelope of gas surrounding the celestial body, that is the environment. In the atmosphere, we say it's the envelope of gases. So we have gases such as oxygen, which we breathe in, carbon dioxide, carbon monoxide, carbon dioxide we breathe out,
We have a nitrogen which is in abundance, but we don't put in nitrogen. We need it, our plants need it to grow, and we eat plants. So as we are eating plants, we are eating nitrogen. So when we die, we decompose, we give back nitrogen into the atmosphere for another cycle to start. So as I've said, we have different gases in the atmosphere, which is one of the components of physical environment. Then we have the hydrosphere, which is the water body. The water body. We have spring, lake, ocean, sea, and so on. Then we also have the lithosphere, which is the solid part of the earth crust. That is that thin layer. Lithosphere, that is the solid part of the earth crust. So on the lithosphere is that thin layer which we find the living sphere. That is where me and you are. That's the biosphere. Then the biological environment, we have the flora and fauna. Flora, fauna, and the microbia. As I've said earlier, flora is the plant, while fauna is animal, and microbes are the microorganism which I cannot see. They are all found in the environment. They all have their usefulness. We feed on plants, we feed on animals. And these microbes, they react on the dead plant and animal for another life to begin. That is for the green plant. Then the cultural environment. This cultural environment, we can say it is the man-made environment, because it gives an idea of learned behavior traits, those that are clear and shared by members of society. Under the cultural environment, we have the social, economic, and political. The social environment reflects the tradition that he or she was grown, lives in, and the community with whom the individual interacts. Take for example, if a person is born in the north and living in the part of northern part of the north, and the person living in the south and born in the south and living in the southern part of the country, we have two different cultural environments, and this they will adapt to, and it will be seen in their way of life. The food they wear, the food they eat, the clothes they wear. So that is the social environment. Then the economic environment refers to the set of favors, set of factors that surrounds the organism, involving monetary, natural, and human resources that influence the behavior of that particular organisms. Then the political environment involves the environment involving conflicting interaction between other organisms, often resulting in the formation of alliances or coalition. And this is used to resolve the conflict and achieve the goals of the allies or their influential members. So that is that about the classes of environment. And I said the classes, all the divisions are three. We have the physical, we have the biological, and we have the cultural. The physical, I say, entails what? Atmosphere, hydrosphere, and lithosphere. Why the biological entails what? Flora, fauna, and microbia. Why the cultural entails the society, politics, and economy. Then we have the components of environment. This component of environment, we look at it under two different schools of thought. We have components of environment as per British literature and components of environment as per American literature. Components of environment as per British literature. This school of thought classified the components of environment in terms of biotic and abiotic. When we say biotic, it means living. Abiotic means non-living. So what are these biotic components? These biotic components are further listed as producers, consumers, and what? Decomposers. We know what producers are. That is the green plants. And then we have consumer. That is that species or animals or organism that depend on a green plant. We know we have primary, consumer, secondary, and tertiary. Then when plants and animals, we say producers and consumer die, the decomposer acts on them for another life to begin. So the three components under biotic, the biotic component, as I've said, is further listed as producers, consumers, and decomposers. While the abiotic component are further classified as climatic, when we say climate, what are those elements of climate that are important? We have water and air. And edaphic, when we say edaphic, we mean soil, or we say land. So it is from this component system that the study of structure of ecosystem was evolved. So as I've said, under the British literature, the two components of environment are biotic and abiotic. When we say biotic, we mean living. So what are these living components? We have producers, that is the green plant, consumers, and the decomposers. Why the abiotic are the non-living? We have climatic and edaphic, or we say soil. Under climate, we have elements such as water and air, and under edaphic, we have land, or we say soil. So these are the components as per British, while by the component as per American, we have atmosphere, hydrosphere, lithosphere, biosphere, and anthroposphere. We have mentioned them earlier, but I will just explain it briefly. Hydrosphere, we mean the water body, or we say water sphere. And this, we say, include all water found on the earth. What are these water bodies? We have ocean, glaciers, streams, lakes, soil, and underground, all the water in the air. So the hydrosphere interacts with and is influenced by all other spheres. It interacts with the lithosphere, the atmosphere, the biosphere, on the earth. So the water of the hydrosphere is distributed among several different stores found in other spheres, which I've mentioned. Water is held in the ocean, lakes, stream, and at the surface of the earth. Water is also found in vapor, that is in the air. In liquid, we find the ocean, the stream, and solid states such as glaciers, ice cap. So the biosphere, that is the living sphere where me and you are, serves as an interface between the spheres, enabling water to move between the hydrosphere, lithosphere, and atmosphere. And it's also accomplished by plant transpiration. Hence, we say the hydrological cycle. What is hydrological cycle? This hydrological cycle traces the movement of water and energy between these various stores and spheres. We can say ocean is the largest water store. It holds it, later it evaporates. Held in the sky as cloud, later it comes down. So that is hydrological cycle. Then the atmosphere, we say it is the air envelope. We say composed of 78% of nitrogen, 21% of oxygen, 0.9% of argon, 0.03% of carbon dioxide, and trace amounts of other gases, which are very, very important to our existence. Then the lithosphere, that is the solid part of the earth, the rocky crust covering the entire planet. This cross is inorganic and is composed of minerals. Then the biosphere, that's where we have the living sphere, where you find the flora, the fauna, and the microbes. That is that part of the earth that supports life. We say flora is plant, while fauna is what? Animal. Why the microbes are tiny organisms, too tiny to see without the microscope. Yet they live everywhere, in the air, in the soil, rock, and water. Then the anthrosphere. This is the man-made environment. This is part of the environment that is modified or made by humans for its own use. So that is that about environment, the definition, the scope, and its classification. Then the next topic is land and agricultural system. Land is perhaps the single most important natural resources in the sense that it affects every aspect of our life. Or people's life, their food, their clothing, and shelter. It is the base for producing raw material for the industry, or we say manufacturing industry. It is also an important resource whereby no nation, city, or rural area can survive as an entity without land. It is very, very important to every person in the nation, to a banker, to an industrialist, to a laborer, to an educator, the student as well, the planner and the farmer, all has a vital stake in country's land problem and its proper utilization. What is the significance of land and its resources to man? One, land is a home and a workplace. He shares with it the entire biotic complex. He has learned through experience the futility of expecting or attempting to draw more from the land that he puts into it. Hence, he practices what rotational or shifting cultivation. In his wisdom, he developed respect for nature and treads humbly on the land. As I've said, land is a home and a workplace for a rural dweller. It's a home as what? A workplace. So, he developed respect for nature and treads humbly on a land. At death, he rests in literal peace. Inside the land, that is earth, which has nourished him all the days of his life. To the urbanite, on the other hand, he expresses predominantly materialistic value. City, or we say land, is simply a commodity to be grabbed, invaded, bought, sold, and even worth stolen. The land is to be owned as a symbol of wealth, power, and what? Prestige. For example, I own 250 hectares of land, and so on. To an urbanite, it's a symbol of what? Wealth, power, and prestige. Then, three, land serves as a social security function to most people because after all else have failed, they could still return to their village to stake a claim on a portion of the family land and raise crop on this for subsistence living. Land also provides the site and material for many production processes such as farming, construction, manufacturing, administration, etc. You want to farm, you must need land. You want to construct, you must need land. When you are constructing, you need cement. Where do we get cement from? Land. The sand, land. Paint, land. Manufacturing, that is adding value for the already existing raw material, we also need land for us to construct the manufacturing industry. Either it's a simple or light industry or heavy industry. You must need what? Land. Then administration, be it school, political environment, cultural environment, you must need what? Land. Then types of agricultural land. We have three types of agricultural land. When we say agricultural land, means when we say agriculture, we means rearing of animals and cultivation of crops for consumption or for commercial purpose. So this type of land that you can put into agricultural practices are divided into three. We have arable land devoted to temporary or seasonal crops. Arable land, that is land that can be put into that can be cultivated, devoted to what? Temporary or seasonal crops. We have food crops or cash crops. Then also another type of agricultural land is that land planted with permanent crops, that is perennial shrubs or trees, from which a useful fruit or sap is harvested regularly and continuously over a growth cycle of several years or decades. You can see the difference. The first one is either temporary or seasonal. When you plant maize, plant maize, beans, and so on, it is what? Seasonal. But if it is land planted with permanent crops, that is perennial shrub, you'll be expecting crops such as fruit. We have sap. We have like oranges, mango, and so on. We have something like rubber, cocoa, and the rest that are permanent crops. And they have the growth cycle of several years or decades. Then we have the permanent pasture land, which is used for like 5 years or more for herbaceous forage crops, either cultivated or growing yield. So these are the three types of agricultural land. So this is where we stop. When next we meet, we'll be looking at other courses on the course outline. So, thank you for listening.